The blue avians and blue sphere beings, do you know what love can do? By William Henry. June 7, 2016. Website. WilliamHenry.net. Produced by Higher Self.
While in Boulder taping my new Gaia TV show, The Awakened Soul, The Lost Science of Ascension, I sat down with Corey Good and David Wilcock for three episodes of their hit program Cosmic Disclosure, Inside the Secret Space Program. Corey is a secret space program whistleblower who tells an astounding story of advanced human civilizations in space, and extraterrestrials called blue sphere beings and blue avians, who are guiding humanity. Hundreds of thousands of people have flocked to Cosmic Disclosure to listen, to lend support to Corey, and to advocate for a reshuffle of the ET human relations deck, and a new beginning for humanity by disclosing the existence of our true place in the solar system. Critics say Corey's story is straight out of the fantasy and sci-fi pulp magazines of the 1920s and 30s. The first question David Wilcock asked me during the interview was if I thought Corey was crazy. "I have no idea," I said. "People believe what they want to believe. Seeing is believing for some. They want proof, pics, video, something. Others see it and believe." Corey, trusting in his sincerity and the vetting of David Wilcock, who is known for his links to ET insiders and whistleblowers. "All I know is I enjoyed talking with both of them. When I first heard Corey's story, I thought, wow, he's talking about two of my favorite subjects, the bird tribe and the blue sphere wormholes or ascension spheres of the ancients. Any minute now I thought he might get into some of the ancient beliefs about these subjects. By the way, neither of these subjects are out of sci-fi magazines. That is, unless you read the ancient Egyptian religious texts, Hindu literature, Native American spiritual tradition and the Bible as sci-fi and interpret Christian art portraying the ascension of Jesus on a blue sphere as fantasy art." Claire and I discussed aspects of these topics, especially the blue spheres, in an episode of our Arcanum series called Ascension Thrones of the Ancients. I revisited the subject directly in an episode of The Awakened Soul called The Blue Sphere and the Soul. After seeing my show, and the historical art I presented, the Gaia producers immediately booked the interview with Corey and David. "What I was saying corroborates Corey's story," they said. The result was an exciting conversation. Well, one interview turned to three. We left a lot more to discuss. It's not every day that one gets to fill in a blank for a dot connector like David Wilcock, but as you'll see in the show, this is exactly what happened. The pearl I dropped on David's door, I am certain, is a gift that will open new pathways for him and all who follow his work. All best blessings to all. Corey was impressed by my photos from the Temple of Horus at Edfa showing Horus, the falcon-headed god, painted blue. He had never seen any of the images I was presenting. His spontaneous reactions were insightful and wonder-inspiring. He reminded me of how I felt when I first took the photos. More, he loved my collection of photos of Horus in blue from Dendera. He was especially impressed that, until 5 years ago when the Egyptians restored the ceiling, the magnificent blue images were covered with black soot. No one knew Horus was blue. Talk about divine timing. We laughed, wondering if they were waiting for Corey's revelation of the blue avians. Where I took Corey and David from there, in my Ascension art collection, blew their minds, pun intended. In this article I will share some key insights from my research on the blue sphere beings and the blue birds. Then, I will share some of my thoughts on the bird tribe that weren't part of our conversation. They are actually insights from two extraordinary mystical sources, The Wizard of Oz and Paul McCartney. I know you will be as amazed as I am about the correspondence. First, a word about the return of the bird tribes. Ever since reading Ken Carey's Return of the Bird Tribes back in 1992, I have been on the trail of an ancient tribe of spiritual beings who continuously manifested to humans for thousands of years, right up to the present, to upgrade humanity, to give us, well, wings. The bird tribes are not birds. They are celestial beings or angels who are master ascension teachers. Carey calls them star people. They really are star people, but in real life they really do not have wings. Carey's book inspired me to research the bird tribe's angelic language, the language of the birds. I wrote a book about it in 1998, but that is another story for another time. My path led me to Egypt and the ibis-headed bird man, Thoth, teacher of the resurrection and ascension mysteries. Thoth resurrects King Seti I, dressed in Osiris's charist garment, from the dead with the ankh or key of life. And to the falcon-headed Horus, the son of Isis and Osiris. In the ancient Egyptian pyramid texts, some of the oldest ascension texts in the world, the deceased king rises into the portals in the sky as Horus, indicating his role in the Stargate mysteries of ancient Egypt. Horus symbolizes the living, eternal light body returning to the stars, becoming a star walker in the dimension of the blessed. These Stargate mysteries came alive for me on the ceiling of Hathor's magnificent Temple of Love and Joy in Dendera, Egypt, where we see various members of the bird tribe, including Isis, the great cosmic mother, and Horus, her son of light, as blue bird people along with blue humans wearing feathered cloaks. Horus on his feathered ascension throne. He holds the ankh and the USA scepter that open the gates of the dimension of the blessed. Our goal, as humans, is to attain this feathered ascension throne and ride the wormholes of eternity. This means, we are to become a being of light, like Horus and the rest of the bird tribe and enter the promised dimension of the blessed. So, there we have it. Blue bird star people, blue avians, in ancient Egypt. Incredible. Right? There is more. Taking a closer look at Horus's shoulder patch, we see that it the logo of the blue birds, the winged serpent. The winged serpent was adopted by Judeo-Christianity as the symbol for the seraphim, angelic beings of pure light and pure love. Seraphim are usually portrayed as red-winged bird men. Red, because they burn with the love of the Creator. However, they are also shown as blue angels or bird men. Blue like the sky. Blue like true blue. These blue birdmen angels are the watchers of the door or gate, linking earth with the heavenly realms. This is why they are shown forming a vesica-shaped gate around the throne of Christ, the new Horus. The seraphim came to earth to teach humans the art of ascension or transformation into angels or blue birds. To be kissed by a seraphim meant to be initiated by them in the secrets of ascension and the mysteries of our divine selves. My bird tribe research led me to become an ascension researcher and a specialist in exploring the secrets of ascension-themed art. To me, there is nothing more fascinating, or imperative that we understand, than the ascension of Jesus. As I wrote in The Secret of Zion, the ascension is a fantastic subject in Christian art, as well as a theme in mystical writings. By the 6th century, the iconography of the ascension had been established, and by the 9th century, ascension scenes were being depicted on domes of churches. The oculus, or eye of the dome, is considered the gateway of the sun. From this gateway at the top of the dome rises the world axis, the link between heaven and earth. Domes, therefore, are the threshold or gateway of the spiritual world. Thus, portraying Jesus ascending in or through a dome symbolizes him traveling through the wormhole. The Syriac Rabbula Gospels include some of the earliest images of the ascension and feature what become standard ascension iconography. They offer the first illustration of Jesus ascending in a radiating or glowing almond-shaped ring or mandorla, gate, lifted to heaven on a chariot composed of whirling wheels within wheels and many-eyed angels' wings. A mandorla is the liminal, threshold, space where two circles overlap. It is a powerful symbol of the psychological and spiritual realm where opposites merge, planes or dimensions of existence meet, and transformation occurs. The whirling wheels within wheels motif is comparable to Ezekiel's vision. As are the lion, bull, man, and eagle, which are symbols of the four evangelists Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the four creatures that guard the throne of God. The Rabula Gospel. Christ ascends in a blue sphere held aloft by angels. So, this early gospel set the blue tone for all future Christian ascension images. However, I believe the imagery originates with the images of Horus on the wormhole boat at Denderah. While the Egyptian art show a side view of the ascending figure, Christian art show the same concept from the face on. In Egypt, we see a side view of the wormhole. In Christian art, we are looking down its throat as Jesus travels through it. That's my take anyway. I have been collecting images of the ascended Christ in a blue sphere. The meaning is clear. The blue sphere is to be imagined as a portal or gateway. I wondered if this is what Corey meant by the blue sphere beings. The Bible calls the blue sphere a cloud, Acts 1:1-11, but it is clearly intended to be understood as a Merkaba vehicle or throne. It has the characteristics of a wormhole, an interstellar or interdimensional transportation device. As the book of Acts tells us, Jesus will return the same way he left, on the cloud/blue sphere wormhole thing. I haven't experienced the blue sphere beings like Corey has, but I did have a powerful encounter with the blue eye of Horus in 2002 while meditating in the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid. From out of nowhere, I saw a blue eye on the screen of my consciousness beaming bliss at me. It was hovering just above me. It was conscious and I knew it was trying to make contact with me. This went on for several minutes. I was awestruck by the experience, even more so when I realized it was the blue eye of Horus that was beaming a blissful love at me. After this experience, I knew I would spend the rest of my life trying to understand what happened, and how to get to that feeling again. Fortunately, I came upon the work of Swami Muttananda, 1908-1982, the founder of the Siddha Yoga spiritual path. While he didn't discuss the Eye of Horus, he did offer an explanation for my experience based on his teaching about the Blue Pearl. According to Muttananda, the experience of the Blue Pearl, also referred to as the Blue Dot, is the most significant of meditation experiences. When Kundalini energy, the God force that ascends our inner tree of life, becomes active through mantra meditation and rises through the seven chakras, many see a subtle blue dot appear and disappear on their mental screen during meditation. The serpent on a pole symbolizes the rising of Kundalini. The Israelites called this symbol the Nehushtan in the story of Moses lifting the serpent of healing. When Moses lifted the serpent, a winged serpent manifested and healed the Israelites. The scriptures describe this blue pearl as the divine light of consciousness, which dwells within everyone. Buddhists teach that through regular and prolonged meditation and focus on the blue pearl, or the blue sphere, one gradually experiences their true nature. More, the blue pearl contains, and provides access to, different planes of existence. When the blue pearl expands, writes Muttananda in Secret of the Siddhas, an extraordinary blue being, some call a blue angel, manifests from the center of its center, in a blue sphere. As I discussed in Starwalkers and the Dimension of the Blessed, traditional shamanic peoples around the world describe a blue pearl, an exquisite, enchanting blue light, that is a mode of transport. It appears in a flash, without any provocation or thought, and opens like a lotus or a wormhole. The Man in Sapphire Blue by Hildegard of Bingen. Jesus, the blue being, manifested to Hildegard in a vision. This being is called the Blue Lord. A visualization of the blue being is considered to be the realization of the form of God. In Hieronymus Bosch's painting, Christ appears as a blue seraph to John the Revelator. The blue being, the embodiment of God consciousness, is made of an extraordinary light, says Muttananda. Just as consciousness expands, or pulsates, pervades the entire universe, and once again contracts, similarly the blue being, consciousness, the great light once again becomes the blue pearl, as tiny as a sesame or mustard seed, and re-enters the body through the eyes. The visualization of the blue being leads to complete knowledge. Can you imagine a seed essence within yourself, a divine blue particle, also called a blue apple, a blue stone or a blue pearl, that blossoms into a new, blue, skin or garment and opens gateways in space that allow instant access to other star systems or even to galaxies billions of miles away, paths that take us back to the source? Strangely, or perhaps not, all this symbolism comes together in Somewhere Over the Rainbow, which some believe is the most hauntingly beautiful, and most esoteric song ever written. It certainly captures the core of our desire, to return home or to make our present home more like our real home. Here are the lyrics. Somewhere over the rainbow way up high. There's a land that I heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow skies are blue. And the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Somewhere over the rainbow bluebirds fly, birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh, why can't I? If happy little bluebirds fly beyond the rainbow, why, oh, why can't I? The message of the song is you can fly with the bluebirds. You can attain the rainbow light body. Dreams do come true. How? By meditating on the blue pearl and getting to know the secrets of the bird tribes. Bluebirds know what love is for. And what it can do. Now, let's turn to the metaphysics of Paul McCartney's song Bluebird. Late at night when the wind is still, I'll come flying through your door. And you'll know what love is for. I'm a bluebird, I'm a bluebird, I'm a bluebird. McCartney's biographer, Jay Blaney, describes this song as a chant and interprets the bluebird as a metaphor for the transcendent power of love, and the liberation of the human spirit from mental and physical bondage. I can't think of a better way to describe the mission of the bluebird tribe of ancient myth and sacred tradition. As McCartney intuited, the bluebirds of the past, including Horus, were messengers of love who came through the secret door and brought the secret of love's power to transform the human spirit. McCartney again. Touch your lips with a magic kiss. And you'll be a bluebird too. And you'll know what love can do. Fly away through the midnight air. As we head across the sea and at last we will be free. You're a bluebird, you're a bluebird. Yes, we can fly over the rainbow like the bluebirds. We can know what love can do. To be touched by the loving kiss of a blue seraph is the ultimate human experience.